And we now move on to questions to the Minister for Employment and Learning. Order, members. I would like to inform the House that question 3 has been withdrawn, and then I would call Mr. Robin Swan.
Question number 1.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. With your permission, I wish to group questions 1 and 6. I would like to an additional minute for the answer. Enabling success, the executive strategy aimed at reducing the level of economic inactivity in Northern Ireland was officially launched on the 20th of April 2015 by my department and the Department for Enterprise, Trade and Investment. However, the strategy has been developed in close partnership with other departments, including DSD, Health and Social Services and Invest Northern Ireland. The implementation of the strategy over the proposed 15-year period is based on 11 key projects to be managed and resourced on a cross-departmental basis. A research mapping exercise of economic and activity service provision in Northern Ireland aimed at the strategy's key target groups has been completed. The Department for Social Development is leading on a pilot project for the new Derry City and Strabane District Council area. This project is based on early and more intensive engagement with new claimants of the Employment and Support Allowance benefit, the biggest single group of clients categorised as economically inactive. However, due to the ongoing pressure on budgets, the Executive has not allocated any significant funding to date, including for the 2016-17 financial year, for the more general implementation of the strategy. At this point in time, therefore, the Enabling Success Strategy remains largely unresourced and its implementation severely hindered. In relation to the proposal that economic activity will become the responsibility of the new Department for Communities, it is my personal view that it would better fit within the new Department for the Economy. However, to reiterate the key issue, given the scope and scale of the strategy and the major challenges therein, these can only be addressed through the total and combined commitment of all of the executive and departments, along with a host of other key stakeholders from every sector.
I call Robin Swan for supplement.
Still concerned with the minister, the minister stating that the economic inactivity strategy is largely unfunded, where our current level of economic inactivity is sitting at 27.2% compared to the UK's at 22%. Does he think the next executive or the next economy minister will tackle this issue more seriously than the current ones have?
Well, I certainly share the concern of the member, but in terms of the fact there's no resources for it, I wouldn't say that we haven't been taking the issue seriously in the fact that this has been a structural problem for Northern Ireland for the best part of 3 decades, and it's only in terms of the current mandate of the Assembly that we've had Northern Ireland's first strategy in that regard, and this is also the first strategy of any part of the UK. But obviously, there's no point in having strategies if they're going to sit on the shelf. And it is certainly my concern, and in this regard I would share the concerns of the member that it is not being implemented. This remains a major structural problem within our economy, and it is something that we have to get to grips with one way or another, both in terms of the lost lives in terms of those who are affected, but also the impact upon our economy if not fully utilising all of the resources available to us.
I call Alistair Patterson.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. And I thank the Minister for his answers so far. Does the Minister agree that there is a contradiction in responsibility for the ESF being retained within the new Department of the Economy, whilst measures to tackle economic inactivity, which are often supported by the ESF, will be in the responsibility of the Department of the Communities?
Well, again, it's worth stating that I have been on record on many occasions saying that all of the employment service should be integrated within the Department for the Economy. And that way you have the full synergies that arise. Obviously, the case for going into the communities is based around, to an extent, ease around different compliance issues. But I think those can be worked across between two departments if necessary. But there's a much greater prize of ensuring that what we're doing is fully linked in to the needs of the economy, and that it's within the setting of the Department of for the Economy that you can do that, and that involves, for example, working closely with employers on a proactive basis, not just in terms of economic inactivity, but a host of other strategies as well to help people to enter and to remain within the labour market. It does go without saying that this has to be something, however, that is addressed on a cross-departmental basis. So no matter what structures in the end are put in place, all the executive need to put their shoulder to the wheel around addressing this particular issue. And I think it's in that light I think we should need to look to the future.
I call Jim Allister.
So we continue to have the highest level of economic inactivity in the whole UK. We are supposed to have a strategy, but it's sitting on a shelf, totally unfunded, and unfunded by an executive which can find £500 million to supplement benefits, but can find no money to encourage a strategy to get people who are economically inactive into work, does not say everything about this miserable failed executive.
I'm not sure if it was a question directed at me in that particular comment or whether it was a largely rhetorical statement. But let me say this. Obviously, we don't have a so-called strategy sitting on the shelf. We have a strategy. It is on the shelf. I do accept that that is the case, and that is not where we should be. And indeed, I have perhaps shared, though maybe expressed them differently, some of the concerns voiced by Mr. Alistair and others about the relative priority that we make. We help those who are vulnerable through a whole host of different types of spending interventions, and welfare payments is only one of those. And indeed, we have to be mindful as well of ensuring that we're not simply keeping people in a situation where they're on welfare, but ensuring that we're providing a ladder to allow people to take advantage of other opportunities. And the economic inactivity strategy should be viewed very much in that regard, where we are helping those who are most vulnerable through trying to give them assistance. So in some ways, you can actually make the case that economic inactivity is a much more benign form of how we address the fact that we have a lot of people who are on welfare in Northern Ireland, as opposed to the more punitive approach that has been forced upon us by the UK government. So the strategy in that regard should be viewed in a positive light. One small piece of light on the horizon, however, lies in the fact that within the Fresh Start deal, and people know the attitude of my party to that overall, there is this notion that there may well be some savings to be found from tackling error and fraud in terms of social security, and that there is the potential for that money to be, amongst other directions, aimed towards resourcing the economic inactivity strategy. So I would certainly urge those who follow in my footsteps to keep a close eye on that as one potential funding opportunity for the future.
I call Phil Flanagan.
I'll ask thank the Minister for his answer. I'm sure the Minister would accept that a significant proportion, if not the majority, of people that are economically inactive actually want to get into work. And would he accept that there exist many barriers preventing people to taking up a job, such as a shortage of affordable and accessible childcare, as well as the availability of jobs in some parts of the North?
Well, I do accept that, and that's the rationale as to why we're having a strategy. I mean, we're not accepting this as being a static situation, that is something that forever must be a feature of the Northern Ireland economy or indeed our society. The strategy is targeting those groups where there are potential barriers. That includes those with work-limiting disabilities who would tend to be slightly more male and older than the population as a whole, and also those with caring and family commitments who tend to be younger on the whole and also tend to be female. And obviously the issue of childcare is one of several of those. We were hoping to do some pilot testing and involve the community and voluntary sector around some projects. No doubt that will touch upon the issue of childcare. But whenever we talk about the cross-executive approach, obviously what can be done in terms of wider childcare policy and resourcing will also have an impact on levels of economic inactivity, whether it's directly through the strategy or on a freestanding basis.
Moving on, I call Kieran McCarthy.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Question number two to the Minister.
The Science Festival ran from the 18th to the 28th of February, and I am pleased to say that it has once again exceeded expectations. Over 120 events took place across Northern Ireland, attracting leading figures in the science world, such as Professor Robert Winston, leading psychologist Professor Richard Wiseman, and Robert Chikui from Thomson Reuters, who delivered the Turing Lecture. Last year's event attracted over 50,000 visitors, and following discussion with the organisers, we anticipate that once the final numbers can be confirmed, even more will have attended this year. My department is the principal sponsor for the festival, and I regard it as an excellent vehicle for promoting the STEM agenda. This is vital, as the skills barometer indicates that skills and jobs related to science, technology, engineering and maths will be central to our future economic success. And we must ensure that a pipeline of suitably skilled people will be available to fill these roles. The festival's events help show how STEM skills form the backbone to a whole range of exciting careers and interests. The aim of the festival is to make science accessible and fun, so events such as Exploding Custard, The Science of Star Wars, and Life as an Astronaut are designed to appeal to a young audience to encourage them to look at science and STEM in new ways. This year I also saw the first STEM Quest Challenge, a STEM-related quiz for school pupils, which attracted over 80 teams. It's very encouraging to see young people enthused by subjects that will form the basis of our future prosperity. I have no doubt that the festival has succeeded in enthusing and inspiring people here about STEM study and careers, and I'm pleased to have committed to supporting the festival for another 3 years.
For supplementary.
Thank you, and I thank the Minister for his fantastic response to the question. And indeed, I want to thank him for all of the answers he has given to this Assembly during the mandate. Unlike the guy behind, the member behind me, who
and
had,
would you like to place a question,
say,
Mr.
McCarthy? I want to pay tribute to Mr. Farry for his sterling work.
Could we have a question, please?
Despite the fact that they wanted to do
order,
his department.
Order. Would the member please pose a question? Mr. McCarthy, please ask the question.
If it hadn't been for the heckling from my left, I would have been able to pay more tribute to Dr. Farry. Can the minister tell the Assembly that this has been so successful it will be carried on despite who is in the minister's department come the next mandate, will be carried on for the benefit of all the young people in Northern Ireland?
Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Can I thank the member for his comments, which I assure you were not scripted in the least, and are spontaneous and from the heart, even though I'm going slightly red. In the response to the actual question from Mr. McCarthy, let me stress that initially, whenever this was brought to the attention of the department, it was hoped that it would attract 10,000 visitors, and very quickly that target was exceeded. This year, we're set to break through even the very successful figures from last year. So this is really capturing the imagination of a whole cross-section of the population of Northern Ireland. And it's done for very important reasons about investing in the future of our economy and making sure that we are enthusing young people about science and the exciting opportunities that flow into the future. I have no doubt that any future Minister of the Economy will wish to support this, but I have given a commitment to the festival organisers of a further 3 years at least in terms of government support for this endeavour. That is not just about how they manage the risk, it's also allowing them to go out with a solid foundation and to better attract more and more commercial sponsors because they know there's that solid commitment from government. This has to be a partnership between both government and the private sector, who will benefit from the STEM skills. So I have no doubt this will be something that will help to ensure this becomes a self-sustaining feature on the calendar for many decades to come.
I call Basil McRae.
Despite the heckling from the man in front of me, I shall ask a question of the Minister in two parts. One, would the Minister care to tell us what was his personal favourite of the many events on the Northern Ireland Science Festival? And secondly, one of the areas that I was at talked about the huge increase in video as part of the internet and that the fibre optic networks are now at capacity. Would he think there is any strategic necessity for Northern Ireland to be investing in further fibre optic networks?
Well, there's probably two aspects to that. I mean, I've certainly taken the opportunity to drop in at a number of different events, as I know the member has as well, and thank him for his support in that regard. And it is important that we do support the festival very directly in that regard. There's also then the ongoing challenge of ensuring that we are investing in science more generally. So, in some respects, I have responsibility for skills, and we have been investing very heavily in STEM. It has been featured not just at my department, but also, to be fair, the Department of Education and indeed DECAL and others as well. We also have to look to the infrastructure around science as well, and we can work with universities directly as a department in that regard, but there may well be other investments that fall elsewhere, and no doubt having a single department of the economy will bring a much sharper focus to that. But it is important that we are investing in what are the key growth sectors in technology to make sure that we remain not just competitive but to the forefront of future developments.
Paul Given is not in his place. I call Trevor Lunn.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Question number five.
I was recently pleased to announce changes in how part-time undergraduate students will receive financial support. Under present arrangements, they can access grants up to £1,230 for their tuition fees, called fee grants. They can also access smaller grants of up to £265 to support them with course-related costs like books and equipment. Both of these grants are, however, income assessed, and to be eligible for the maximum fee grant, the student's income must be below £16,843. While these grants can be really important sources of support for students from lower income backgrounds, about three quarters of our part-time students are not eligible to receive them. Furthermore, even the maximum fee grants are often not enough to cover the full cost of tuition fees charged. Last June, I launched a consultation to consider options to improve the part-time support package. Following that consultation, I announced the decision to introduce a top-up tuition fee loan for part-time students. This solution will protect grant-based support for those who need it most, while also allowing students to top up those grants with loans should they need to, up to the equivalent value of the full-time tuition fee loans, depending on the student's intensity of study. This combination of grants and loans for part-time tuition fee support is unique within the UK. It will vastly improve access to financial support for part-time students and ensure closer parity with their full-time counterparts. But introducing this improved student support is not only a matter of social justice, it's also an economic imperative as we contend with increasing skill demands and the need to upskill and reskill our existing workforce. The new loan subject to the Student Loans Company implementation should be available from the 2017-18 academic year.
I call Trevor Lunn for supplementary.
Yes, I thank the Minister for his answer, and this is a very welcome change in policy and practice, and once again Northern Ireland leads the way in terms of employment and learning. Could I ask the Minister what type of outcomes would he envisage under this very welcome change in practice?
I thank the Member for his comments, and recognising that we are being very innovative in what we are doing in Northern Ireland with the combination of the grant and loan approach, which is not offered in other parts of the UK. What we're trying to do is to recognise that we have still a relatively small footprint in terms of part-time study. We are trying to widen higher education out to a much wider range of potential of students from different types of backgrounds and age groups. We're moving away from the notion that a student is an 18 to 21-year-old in full-time education, full-time higher education. So it's important that we are encouraging people into higher education. It also allows us to support emerging strategies, in particular the new apprenticeship strategy, where we are looking to ensure that we are providing the skills that companies require. And it is going to be possible now to do a degree-level apprenticeship where someone is employed and learning on the job while at the same time studying at university. In that context, it would be a part-time study. So this allows us to offer wider support to the implementation of that strategy. So that way we are going to deliver both for students in terms of fresh opportunities, but also for our local employers and therefore our economy.
Does the Minister accept that this change will enable people in work to avail of part-time courses to enhance their skills and qualifications?
Yes, thank the Member for the question. Very much agree with him. It's about widening out higher education to a diverse range of groups, and this will support people who are in work to avail of higher education. Across the UK, we actually have seen a major drop-off in terms of the figures of people doing part-time study in terms of where they've been supported by their employers. I think that was perhaps one of the first casualties of the economic downturn over the best part of the past decade. So hopefully through what is a revised form of support, we will be encouraging and facilitating much greater numbers to avail of part-time higher education, and we know that we have to upskill our population if we are to be competitive, so it's critically important in that regard.
I call Sandra Overend.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for his response. I wonder, can the Minister explain why he introduced the four-year limit before students start to repay loans?
It's an issue in terms of pragmatism around this, in terms of ensuring that what we're doing is going to be fair and workable for those who are taking advantage of this. In the main, we have sought to ensure that we are in line with what is the parity with the full-time counterparts, but that won't always be the case in terms of this. There will also be a situation where obviously people are actually in work as well whenever they're doing this, which may be a slightly different context from those who are doing the part-time study, and it's important that we reflect that as well in terms of how we construct the repayment framework around this.
I call John Dallett.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, I wonder, at the risk of upsetting Kieran McCarthy, could I ask the Minister if he would accept that in the past, historically, the technical education system provided a second chance for many people who slipped through the net the first time round? And would he agree that there are many people out there today who are perhaps single parents and really need a package to re-engage in higher education, and would he encourage successor, whoever it is, to look seriously at part-time graduation and make sure that people can afford it?
I would agree with the member on all the points he made, though apart from the fact of upsetting Mr McCarthy, he probably agrees with the comments that the member was making as well. In that regard, he's very resilient, our Mr McCarthy. But the member is right. I mean, this is there to appeal to a whole wide range of people from different backgrounds. So there is a major issue in terms of widening participation on the back of this, where we can better support people with a whole range of different work or indeed domestic contexts, and that would include, for example, as members outlined, single parents who may see the notion of doing a full-time degree as being something impossible to combine with their other caring commitments, but a part-time study becomes a very viable option. Equally, there may well be people who feel obliged to engage in the world of work given their domestic circumstances who also want to improve their life chances and to do a degree. Hopefully we're going to be facilitating them as well.
Could I remind members to ensure that they are speaking into a microphone for the benefit of Hansard? And could I now call Ross Hussey?
Mr Deputy Speaker,
I'm pleased to report all 66 projects on the 2014-20 programme are now fully up and running, with the programme providing funding of £112 million, which will significantly contribute to the programme's overall target of supporting 42,000 people. Many of the projects have been operational since April last year, while some other EU-funded programmes in the 2014-20 funding round, both here and in other parts of the UK, have yet to initiate their application processes. As the first year of the programme draws to a close, I'm also pleased at the level of matched funding support that my department has been able to provide for a significant number of projects. In order to ease cash flow issues for the new projects, I have agreed to my department implementing an interim measure whereby 100% of European Social Fund and Dell contribution in unpaid claims is paid now and vouched later. Applying this process has alleviated initial financial pressures which the projects have experienced, and work continues apace to ensure that all claims are subsequently fully vouched in line with audit requirements. In tandem with this, the Department has brought further staff into the ESF Managing Authority in order to assist with the vouching of all claims. I am confident that this combination of short-term measures has gone a significant way to addressing the backlog of claims and will soon bring the Managing Authority to a position whereby it can efficiently vouch each individual claim as and when it arrives. My department's key priority in developing any element under the current programme is to ensure that the participants receive the best possible training and education available to them. The primary rationale is to ensure quality throughout education and training, and we cannot and should not lose sight of the fact that it is the participants in ESF projects and therefore the quality of training they receive that should remain our primary focus. My officials are working with ESF providers to develop a policy paper to examine where any justifiable flexibilities may lie in relation to the teaching qualification requirement. They are working to conclude this exercise before the end of March. However, it is important that the rationale for the introduction of this requirement is clearly understood.
I call Ross Hussey for a supplementary.
I thank the Minister for his response thus far. Does the Minister share the Stakeholder Forum's concerns that there is a lower level of teacher qualification available in FE colleges here than is required to deliver ESF?
Well, I thank the Member for his comment and question. Let me say that we are fully alert to the comments that we have received from a whole range of stakeholders around the teaching requirement. This has been put in place not out of any notion of creating an unfair or a high bar, but to ensure that people right across the training education landscape are being trained by people who are suitably qualified. Now, that said, we are conscious, and probably in two different directions, of the need to consider potential flexibilities. One is around the timescale around which people can avail of the need to get qualifications and the capacity of the system to respond to that, though I am assured that the capacity is there nonetheless. The second aspect is, are there particular circumstances where the requirement for the teaching qualification isn't actually making any sense? I mean, for example, we're talking around some very narrow recreational activities or, for example, some health and safety aspects. So we are potentially looking at that, and that's some of the issues that we're currently reviewing with a view to having an outcome before the end of March.
Raymond McCartney is not in his place. I call Alex Maskey.
Mr. Rennie, please, question number 9.
I am pleased to report that my department has made significant progress implementing the new system of youth training and apprenticeships. The new youth training pathway offers great opportunities for participants to gain the skills they need to enter the workplace and provide a strong foundation for long-term employment and education. In September, 16 traineeship pilots were launched across a range of occupational areas, including engineering, ICT, construction, health and social care, business administration and hairdressing. Approximately 250 young people are taking part in the pilots, and feedback initially has been extremely positive. Implementing the strategy will establish a high-quality network of providers capable of delivering the off-the-job training associated with traineeships. FE colleges, employer providers and other high-quality non-FE providers who meet our quality standards can be part of that network. Through the new model, employers and participants will be in the lead, having the choice of which provider to use, supported by impartial advice from my department's career service to ensure young people make informed choices. The content of traineeships will also be guided by employers. We have already set up employer groups to help us to develop a new training system through a series of sector partnerships and an overarching interim strategic advisory forum. Future traineeships will be available via a web portal, which will allow employers to advertise opportunities and participants to find suitable opportunities. I have assigned a £15 million budget for the next financial year to drive the continued development of the new systems of apprenticeships and youth training through 2016 and beyond.
I call Alex Maskey.
Can I thank the Minister for that quite comprehensive response, and could I ask the Minister, and specifically in relation to the policy commitment around supporting and giving additional flexibility for young people who may have conditions of disabilities or caring commitments or leaving care, is the Minister in a position to give us any further information in regard to that policy commitment?
Yeah. Well, the member will appreciate that we have a range of current interventions in that regard. For example, there are flexibilities within the current Training for Success programme, both in terms of young people with a range of disabilities and also those who have caring responsibilities. And beyond Training for Success, those are also reflected in terms of how FE and also universities respond to the particular needs of young people. Within the new system, a very heavy focus has been placed upon meeting the individual needs of young people, so there may be a much stronger focus around pastoral support, and the very particular issues or barriers being faced by young people will be factored into the approach that will be taken both by employers and the various training providers. So that's been very much hardwired in to the strategy, and that will be a key focal point for implementation over the years ahead.
I call Karen McKevitt.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Question 10.
At this time, my department has no immediate plans for major capital investments in the Newry campus of Southern Regional College. However, my department is currently providing £91 million funding for the college to develop new campuses in Armagh, Banbridge and Craigavon. In developing the outline business case for the project, the college decided that its estate in Newry should not be included within the scope of the business case, as it had received previous investment and was in a condition to meet the needs of the college. The department has a limited amount of capital funding available to meet the needs of all six FE colleges, and funding is allocated to projects on the basis of need, as evidenced by approved business cases. Over the next 4 years, my department will provide funding for major construction projects in four of the colleges. In addition, the department allocates capital funding to colleges to carry out minor works across their estates. Colleges are able to set their own priorities in relation to minor works, providing their statutory and legal requirements in relation to health and safety and other areas are met.
Call Karen McKevitt for supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and can I thank the Minister to date. And I am aware of the continuing development right across Armagh, Craigavon and Banbridge, with the colleges proceeding with planning applications for development. But would the Minister support the college if a future business case were to be presented, if an opportunity were to occur with the freeing up of the release of the Newry Sports Centre? And that would help consolidate the campus's provision in the city of Newry to a level of match investments which other areas are currently seeing.
Well, I certainly understand that the logic and rationale of seeking further investment in terms of the FE estate in Newry. And I wouldn't discourage the college in any way, shape or form in terms of making representations. But to be realistic about this, we have a fixed amount of capital coming down the tracks, and at present, the amount of potential investment in the FE estate is probably going to exceed any future likely a capital allocation to the new Department for the Economy. And just to put this in context, in addition to the three campuses within the Southern Regional College area alone, which are Banbridge, Armagh, and the new one in Craigavon, replacing Lurgan and Portadown, we have recently approved a business case in relation to Northern Regional College, who haven't had any major investment for quite some time. There's also a major development that's advancing in terms of Enniskillen. Recently, we've concluded an investment in Bangor. There's also potential plans in terms of the Northwest Regional College campuses in the Northwest as well. So there's a lot of capital projects building up in the works, which is good in many respects because we are investing in a modern estate. But being realistic, I don't see Newry advancing to the front of that queue. There's a lot of backlog in the system to work through already. But by all means, the college can keep making the case.
And that is the end of our period of time for... Order. That's the end of our period of time for listed questions, and we now move on to topical questions. And I call Chris Hazard.
Perhaps I could ask the Minister to maybe outline what he and his department have done to create modern apprenticeship routes for some of our young people. And I think specifically of the young people in South Down, where construction would have been played a large part in the local economy. And if there's viable options for our young people in relevant construction apprenticeships going forward?
Well, starting from the general first, we have new strategies in place for both apprenticeships, which are now run from level 3 through to level 8, and also for traineeships at level 2. They will be fully operational from September 2017 onwards, and we're currently in the pilot phase around different aspects of those. At present, we have also the outgoing apprenticeship NI contracts and training for success contracts. These are very deliberately designed to ensure that we are providing opportunities for young people and also ensuring that we're providing the skills required by employers. And we expect that employers will now be in the driving seat in terms of determining where training will occur. We are working to have a sector partnership put in place, which will relate particularly to the needs of the construction sector. The member will already be aware that there's a strong infrastructure in place through the Construction Industry Training Board, for example, and also different groups that will also lobby on behalf of the sector. So that will push well in terms of developing the development of new frameworks in terms of those areas. But as demand changes in key sectors, employers are incentivised to respond to ensure that we are then meeting their particular demands, and the infrastructure will be in place to facilitate that.
I call Chris Hazard for supplementary.
Thank the Minister for his answer. But just on to that, Are we going to ensure that equal amount of opportunities is open to young women when we do this? Obviously, there's a need to probably address gender imbalance when it comes to construction apprenticeships in specific. Thanks.
Well, absolutely, and indeed, gender and some other equality issues are a key feature within the apprenticeship and youth training strategy, because we want to ensure that we are open to people from all different backgrounds, and in particular, we're trying to break down some of the stereotypes that revolve around some particular jobs. Just to put this in wider context, for example, I was today down at the Titanic building for the launch of National ICT Day and as part of the Bring It On campaign, where we're trying to encourage more and more school children to consider careers in the IT sector. And that's another area where the sector has been very heavily male-dominated historically. And if we want to truly compete in the global marketplace, we need to make sure we're bringing through fully the local marketplace of talent. And that is not exclusive to either gender, depending upon which occupation we're looking at. And construction fits into that just as much as any.
I call Gordon Dunn.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, can the Minister advise on what he is doing to ensure that Bombardier continues to offer apprenticeships? And we do appreciate the work you have done in trying to address the issue of the loss of jobs, but I think it is important that they, as a major employer, continue to offer apprenticeships in what are real opportunities.
Yes, I mean, I thank the member for the question. As the Assembly will know, Bombardier have historically been one of the flagship companies with respect to apprenticeship training in Northern Ireland for many years, and they very regrettably have taken the decision to suspend their apprenticeship programme. by coincidence, I'm actually meeting Bombardier tomorrow morning to discuss some of those issues, including what can be done around training opportunities, because we don't want to lose that route of bringing more and more young people into the aerospace sector, which is so important to the future of our economy. I've also had meetings with the trade unions on this issue, and indeed they're obviously concerned as well about the loss of the apprenticeship programme in terms of the current suspension and what that means for the refreshing and replenishing of the workforce. So I think there's issues that we want to put to the company over the coming days, and I'm actually more than happy to write to the member in that regard, just to give him a more detailed readout as to where things may be moving in that direction after the meeting.
I call Gordon Dunn.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister indeed for his work over the past term, and especially the good work he done in Bangor in relation to delivering a theatre at the Cirque College, so well done on that. But in relation to Bombardier, Does he fully realise how valuable a Bombardier apprenticeship is to a young person, and that is a great start in life? And will he do all he can to try and retain those opportunities? We've had a commitment from Invest NI that they are continuing to talk to Bombardier on the issue. So what we want is an assurance that
the members asked the question. Minister, please.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Can I say that first of all, I'm very impressed by how the member has embraced the arts over the past number of years. As someone who historically was viewed as a bit of a Philistine by his own definition, has now reached the dizzy heights of being a real connoisseur of the arts, no doubt through his current role on the committee. The member will know what I'm talking about in that regard. But moving on to the very serious points, I'm absolutely committed to working with the company to ensure that we do everything we can to ensure that we have that pipeline of young people coming through. It's important that we have a critical mass of trained apprentices for the aerospace sector. While my department and Invest work very closely with Bombardier around the current situation, we hope that we will turn the situation around, and we have already had assurances that Bombardier have a long-term future in Northern Ireland. But beyond Bombardier, we have a much wider supply chain, and we also have clearly the potential to grow the sector over the next 10 to 15 years, with potential for a £1 billion industry to emerge in Northern Ireland. So it's important that we do everything we can to work in terms of ensuring that we have that skills base. I know Invest Northern Ireland share that aspiration. My officials are working very closely with them as to how we can best address the current situation that we find it with Bombardier. But we have a number of ideas that we want to put to them tomorrow morning, and in that regard I'm going to get in touch with the member just to outline afterwards where that's going to fall.
Katrina Rowan is not in her place. I call Gerard Diver.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and just on behalf of the SDLP, can I also thank the Minister for his work in quite difficult circumstances, given the challenges around higher and further education. Could I ask the Minister, given his earlier comments about support specifically for part-time undergraduate students, which is very, very welcome, does he envisage that there will be support coming forward in the new mandate, particularly for our postgraduate students, and given the importance of that to our economy taking it forward?
Well, thank the member for his comments. We've already discussed the issue of part-time study, but also that there's a need for us to also encourage more and more people to engage in postgraduate study. Already we have a number of studentships which are awarded through the universities, which will support people primarily to do PhDs, and that's important. And we've seen some major developments over the past number of years in terms of where Northern Ireland stands in terms of the knowledge index, which rates the number of PhDs per capita across the 12 different regions of the UK. There's a very particular issue that's facing us all across the UK in terms of how we encourage more people to do taught masters. We have also consulted on this, and subject to receiving Treasury approval within the next couple of weeks, it is my intention to make a similar announcement that we have done in relation to part-time study, in relation to master's study within the next number of weeks.
Gerard Diver for supplementary.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and can I thank the Minister for his answer. In overall terms, Minister, do you think that there is any potential for this to affect the broader levels of support that are available for students overall, both graduate and postgraduate?
What we're proposing in relation to part-time and potentially in relation to masters is additional to the existing student support regime. What we're hoping to do is to access loans through the Treasury through the annual managed expenditure, and that's the particular sign-off that we're just waiting for before we can proceed with any formal announcement in relation to supporting postgraduate study. There is a much wider issue in terms of student support and its sustainability. I think there is a broad consensus in the Assembly that we want to facilitate students as best we can, and that we don't want to tinker with the student support system, whether we're talking about the levels of tuition fee loans or whether we're talking about things like maintenance grants. However, that does come at a price because the money is not being spent in England on those. We don't get the Barnet consequentials coming across, so we have to find those resources out of our own budgets. So there's always an ongoing challenge to ensure that we are directing the necessary investment into our different institutions. We have fallen short in that regard over the past number of years, and I have deep concerns around the sustainability of our higher education system as a result of this. So some very difficult decisions will have to be taken, and it does look likely that the most viable political route for the executive is to ensure that we are directing sufficient resources into the system more directly, as they have sought to do in Scotland. But that will be a challenge, and it has to be an immediate priority for the incoming executive in May.
I call Stuart Dixon.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. Minister, can I too also congratulate you on the way in which you have developed your department during your time in office, and whoever your successor is will have a hard job to follow, and if it's you, it will be an easy job to follow.
And could we have a question?
And I will come to a question. Minister, you made a very positive contribution in the delivery of free English classes to immigrants to Northern Ireland, to this part of the United Kingdom. Can you tell the House how you believe that will make a contribution to their overall integration into our society in Northern Ireland?
Well, thank the member for his comments. As the Assembly will appreciate, we have a number of people who have come to Northern Ireland either to seek asylum or as refugees. And the refugee population will obviously include people from Syria, but not exclusively from Syria. We do need to see a cross-departmental response in this regard. I do believe the Northern Ireland Executive is very much seized of this, and it's important that all departments do their part in that regard. And our commitment to free ESOL classes is very much part and parcel of that. That applies to all asylum seekers and all refugees, irrespective of where they're coming from. And hopefully we'll make that commitment. I think in particular at this time, as we're seeing a lot of fear and division emerge across the world, and including within Europe, it's important that Northern Ireland that does send out that very loud and progressive voice that we want to welcome refugees to our shores, and we will very much value them and see them playing an active role within our society.
I call Stuart Dixon.
Thank you, and I appreciate the answer the Minister has given. Minister, given the contribution that those who come into Northern Ireland from outside can make, they will undoubtedly add to the skills mix in Northern Ireland. But are you satisfied, Minister, that with the requirements for a reduced corporation tax rate, that we will have the required skills mix, including those who come by way of immigration to Northern Ireland?
Well, there is an issue for us, very particularly around immigration, where we do need to look to some flexibilities around immigration policy that currently exist in terms of Scotland that don't currently exist in Northern Ireland. So we're very much driven by the needs and definition of the economy in the southeast of England rather than in Northern Ireland. We will meet our skill requirements through a combination of people coming to Northern Ireland from elsewhere, and that's in many ways a positive sign that we're open to the rest of the world and that we are attractive for people to come to. We can take encouragement from that, but we also have to ensure that we are developing the local skills base as well. As a full supporter of a lower level of corporation tax and believing it can transform our economy for the future, it is nonetheless important that we have a proper plan in place to make sure it will be a success, because it won't be a success without that plan. So that means investing in infrastructure. It also means investing in the right level of skills, and that requires ensuring that we are investing in our colleges, universities and apprenticeships in sufficient volume so that we will meet the expectations of potential employers, either inward investors or those from Northern Ireland who wish to grow right here in their own domestic economy.
I call Chris Little.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. As a member of the Committee for Employment and Learning that proposed a review of careers guidance in 2012, can I welcome the work the Minister has done on this issue and ask him for an update in relation to the careers education and guidance strategy that he launched today?
Well, as the member will be aware, the Education Minister and myself did launch Preparing for Success 2015 to 2020, which is the joint career strategy between our departments. And this has been the culmination of quite a lot of work over the past number of years, and we'd recognise the contribution of the member as part of the committee, and also the wider committee themselves in terms of the inquiry that they did take forward as part of this policy development piece. And indeed, right through to the employment bill, which was passed this morning, we have seen the evidence of that inquiry, not least in terms of the new statutory duty on the department in relation to careers advice. We've also had that an independent panel that was chaired by Brian Ambrose from Belfast City Airport that very much brought business and education together in terms of recommendations. What we're trying to do here is to ensure that we are servicing both the needs of individuals in terms of providing them with informed but impartial careers advice, and also ensuring that companies themselves are confident that we are investing in the foundation stone of the economy by ensuring that young people are getting advice in areas that are relevant to their emerging needs.
And that is the end of our period of time for questions to the Minister. Could I ask members to take their ease for a few moments as we change staff at the table.